once more. My name is Desmond Hunter, and I will be your moderator for this evening lecture. Welcome to this evening lecture given to you by the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research Incorporated. It is a school, not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any other religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing the proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of this eternal purpose is patterned on the plan of our throughout eternity till this present day. Now, this school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford King, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were later on incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Now, since that time, we have established grand school throughout the United States, Canada, Africa, and certain other foreign countries. Our local grand school was established in Kingston, Jamaica in the year 1988, and our Spanish Town branch was incorporated in the year 1994. Now, at this time, let me introduce one official of the Spanish Town grand school, the president, Dr. Leah Jack. Now, at this school, we teach by the true name of our Heavenly Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, containing the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted as Lord. The true title for the Word, our Son, is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted as God. The true name and title for the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of our physical body, is Yahshua, the Messiah. It has been erroneously substituted as Jesus Christ. Our Lord and God are titles, not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and verse 5 that there are lords many and the gods many, but we now know each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Now, Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title, but this therefore means Elohim is a title our Creator chose for himself. Not Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia will show proof that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek, nor the Latin language has any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J, and neither was the letter J the English language until some 1400 years after Yahshua Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus, Jehovah, and Jack, impossible rendering of the true original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Our Christ is entitled just like Lord and God. So, thank you so much, Jack, and I would like to direct your attention here. Now, Yahweh is your spirit. And in this state, Yahweh is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and invisible. Yahweh is the ultimate source, the infinite and immaculate substance. Yahweh is the limit and the bounds of everything. And we have Yahweh in your spirit state, symbolizes and discharged as a cloud. However, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize or to depict himself, because a cloud has no particular descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this orange fire cloud. All around the edges of this chart to show you how that everything on this chart abided in this cloud. Now, in like manner, does everything in the universe abide within the pure spirit state of Yahweh? Now, Yahweh, knowing man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. Now, this is the Word, our Son, a super incorporeal being, or a great heavenly anthropomorphic being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. His form could only receive the divine vision and understood in divine revelation. Now, later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously called Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given to salvation, and we must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plainly? A further understanding of this name and title may be helped by reading the preface of the Holy Bible. So the school teaches by the divine pattern of the universe. Now, it is called the divine pattern because it's Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses at Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. So Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. See, the pattern consists of a most holy place, and a court round about. Now these three compartments make up this one tabernacle pattern. Now we go out in this school to show you how that everything in this universe is made and operate according to the structure and the function of this tabernacle pattern. And that absolutely nothing escape this pattern. We know as we have 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims, and they are as follows. First aim is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without the distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, class, or color. Third aim is to investigate and explain spirit law or the so-called law of nature and the power latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the studies of the scripture, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult sense. Fifth aim is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operations of Yahweh's eternal purpose, operating through the dispensation and ages. Seventh aim is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. Aim is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved. Save the Yahshua the Messiah. 10 aim is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan, speak the truth. Okay. For this, after people went up there in the North Carolina Grand School, we will have prayer right after Junior Williams. Scripture lesson will be taken from Hebrews 12 chapter, read by Dr. Mark.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Bow our hearts to Yahshua. We give thanks unto thee once more, Yahshua, for bringing us here. And we gladly accept this invitation. May you continue to feed us righteously and fatten our souls, that there is none else but thee. All praise be to you, Yahshua. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Such contradiction of sinners,
against himself, lest you be weary and faint in your minds. Ye have yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not the chastening of Yahweh, nor faint when ye are rebuked of him. For whom Yahweh loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If you endure chastening, Yahweh dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? But if you be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we have a father of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chasteneth us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth a peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore lift up the hands which hang down, and the feet of you, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Follow peace with all men, and holiness, without which no man shall see Yahweh, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of Elohim, lest any root of bitterness spring up from it, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person, as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For you know how that afterward, when you have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. For you are not come unto the mouth that might be touched, and that burnt with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet, and the voice of words which voice they had heard, entreated that the word would not be spoken to them anymore. For they should endure that which was commanded, and if such as a beast touch a mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. But ye are come unto Mount Zion, and unto the city of the living Elohim, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and assembly of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to Yahweh the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men in the perfect, and to Yahshua the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. See that you refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escaped not who refuse him that spake on earth, much more shall not be escaped if you turn me from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shall not the earth only, I shall shake not the earth only, but also the heavens. And this word yet once more signified the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken will remain. Wherefore, we receive in a kingdom which cannot be removed, let us have grace whereby we may serve Elohim, accepting with reverence and righteous fear. 29th and last verse. For our Elohim is the consuming fire. I have read to you Hebrews the 12th chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Good evening.
So it's a great privilege and pleasure to be able to stand up here and give a reason, a testimony of this divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Richard Tuesday. In the year 1931, June 6, 9 o'clock in the morning, when the hour talked in a month, and she wants to know the word where that very great it really is and actually exists. As a foremost important for us to attain to this name, Yahshua, because this name is salvation. You understand? In John 17, 1 to 3, these verses made Yahshua and lift up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, thou hast come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also be glorified thee. As thou hast given it for over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given it. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the holy true Elohim. Yahshua Messiah, Yahweh of sin. That's eternal life. But that's what we come down here for, is eternal life. You understand? Now, the scripture list, you ready for coming? Scripture list.
Hebrews chapter 12.
Yeah.
Says, Hebrews 12. Wherefore? Seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses.
So great a cloud of witnesses. Now Yahweh give us many witnesses. Oh, Yahweh give us many, many witnesses to show that Yahweh exists and he is. Read.
Let us lay aside every weight.
Let us lay aside the burden. Every weight. Yahweh's my burden is life. My yoke is easy and my burden is life. If not really get a burden. Read.
And the sin which doth so easily beset.
Read.
And let us run with patience the race that is set before us.
Paul said, what about the race? What about the race? Read.
Hebrews 12 verse 2. Mm-hmm. Looking unto Yahshua.
Looking unto Yahshua.
The author and finisher of our faith.
And he is the one that finished. He is the author and finisher of our faith. And it said Hebrews 6 and 1, I think. It said it's impossible to please Yahweh without faith. So they that come to us, they that come to Yahweh must first believe that he exists. And how you know Yahweh exists? Because it's naturally spirit materialized and Yahweh is spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Read.
Yeah. Who for the joy that was set before him.
Yeah.
Endured the cross.
Endured the cross, right? Read.
Despising the shame.
Yeah.
And is set down at the right hand of the throne of Yahweh. For consider him that endured
yeah,
such
the sixth verse. Get the sixth verse.
Verse 6 of Hebrews chapter 12. Mm-hmm. For whom Yahweh loveth.
For whom Yahweh loveth.
He chasteneth.
And that's what I said, that's why John, he said, we love Yahweh because he first loved us. And it's a great love story, don't it? Just like you said over here, right? You see Adam and Eve, right? And look here, look at this plate here, Adam and Eve. You see Adam here, and you see Eve, and you see Lucifer tried to steal his Eve. In other words, what really happened? Lucifer tried to steal Adam one. And he died for her, right? He died for her. Guess what? That's when Lucifer tried to steal Yahshua's bride, and Yahshua died for us. And that's through the gospel. And that's showing the love. It's a great love story. Yahshua the Buddha by Yahweh, two chapters and 10 down. Living in a special 3.5 years. Right? Ministry for 3.5 years, right? Die, buried, resurrect. You understand me? Outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That's some great love, don't you? That's what I was at that minute. You understand now what Yahweh? The chain of prison in bondage. 430 years. Them can't live by themselves. So Yahweh gave them a formula for to live by themselves, right? It's like you go to the doctor. They say, doctor, no, my head is hurting me. He said, I want you to take these tablets 3 times a day after me. Now, if you follow instructions, you understand it, right? After doctor, you will get better. You understand? We're going to do what we expect. So guess what? Yahweh gave them a formula down here to live by themselves. But he gave them the name and the gospel. From a fear to Moses, he gave them the name and gave them the gospel. Right down into the liver, physical, Egypt down here. I remember one is not an Israelite, old God, they don't want Egypt, God. It's a deliver physical, Israelite down here, you understand? For a believer, him tell them what to do. So they must take out a lamb, you understand? And they must kill the lamb.
right? That's death. And they went through the tide water and the Red Sea, that's death, burial. And then 3 days after the resurrection, the wilderness. And they went through the wilderness. Death, burial, resurrection. And the third day. And the new birth, that's it. You understand? But they don't kill the lamb anyway. They kill the lamb. Put, in other words, they pierce the lamb in the side, out came blood. You understand me? And then, sea water, blood water, and it was like kitchen in the spirit, then she did cloud within the spirit, that blood water spirit. And it was in the wilderness 40 years. That's what Yahweh gave us, physically. Israelite. You understand me? Now this four-footed lamb is testifying of the two-footed lamb. That's why when John saw in John 1:29, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh, will take away the sin of the world." So this four-footed lamb is testifying of the two-footed lamb. And this lamb was without blemish. You understand? The first of a, you understand me? It was only a male lamb, right? This lamb is testifying of Yahshua, this lamb. You understand me? Now, get the Jonah now, though. Where's that the gospel this evening? Show you the simplicity of the gospel. The gospel proving that there's life after death. Here's something to look forward to. Because remember the days of time when there was no physical, the angel of creation, there was no physical, and Yahweh killed the end from the beginning. You understand? So how are we going to operate when we're without the body? Read.
Jonah chapter 1. Now, the word of Yahweh came unto Jonah the son of Amittai.
The word of Yahweh came unto Jonah. Because you have the living word, the spoken word, and the written word. Let me talk about the living word with the head of it. Since the word came unto Jonah, say, now, look here, read John 1:1. This is what we have, John 1:1. In the beginning was the word. You know, some people say the Bible is the word, right? But that makes no sense. You say the beginning was the Bible. The Bible was in the beginning. The beginning of what? Think about it. They say the beginning was the Word. Read.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
And now you wouldn't have the Spirit. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
Yes.
All things were made by Him.
That's in Ephesians. All things were made by Him.
And without Him was not anything made that was made.
Right? Read.
In Him was life.
In Him is life. Read.
And the life was the light of men.
Read.
And the light shineth in darkness.
Yes.
And the darkness comprehended it not.
Yes.
There was a man sent from Yahweh.
Yes. Alright, get to the 14th verse now.
John chapter 1, verse 14.
Yes.
Up to you. And the Word was made flesh.
And the Word was made flesh. The other time we never make flesh at no time. The Word was made flesh. And dwelt among us. Yes.
And we beheld His glory.
And we beheld His glory.
His glory. As one of the begotten of the Father.
Full of truth.
And
the
Word.
Full of grace and truth. Saying not the written word, it's the living word it's talking about. I will read Revelation, we'll get that Revelation, the word was this in that. We get it Revelation 13, 19, something like that. You know why you get me? Read. You see how you get me?
Revelation
13. In Jeremiah, with the word. Yes?
Revelation 13.
We're still on the gospel, we just talk some of the word. Read.
The word.
Read after me something said. Read.
Revelation 19.
19, 30.
And He was clothed,
yes,
with a vesture,
yes,
dipped in blood.
Yes.
And He was called
the Word.
The Word of Yahweh.
Remember I said, He dipped the robe in the blood of the Lamb, and it was white as snow, so it was not red. Right? You understand it? Right? So He dipped, but it was white as snow, right? The whole Word is Jeremiah. The Word. Jeremiah 1:4, I don't know.
Jeremiah 15,
yes.
Verse
15. And then go on. Genesis, the word word. 15 and something. Read.
Jeremiah 15, verse 16. Thy words were
found. Yeah, so the prophet is saying, thy words were found. And I did eat them. Now think about it. Here's somebody I read in the Bible. I want the living word, but I also let the word, if the man shall not be by bread alone, but by every word
that proceeded out of the mouth. You understand? Says living word, being the spoken word. So that's where you went. E. Why? Because the ear tried word as the mouth tasted me. So you eat your mouth for this natural ear. But the ear, all the soul eat is through your ear. So the ear tried words as the mouth tasted me. So it could be the words. And eat wholesome words too.
Deuteronomy 8:2.
Yes.
And he humbled thee.
Yes.
And suffered thee to humble.
Yes.
And fed thee with manna.
Yes.
Which thou knewest not.
Yes.
Neither did thy fathers know.
Yes.
That he might make thee know.
Yeah.
That man doth not live by
that bread. Man doth live bread by bread only.
By bread only.
But
by every word
that proceeded
out of the mouth of Yahweh.
Because when Yahweh speak to them from the mountain here, them disobey the words of Yahweh.
Doth man live?
You understand? Say so you want to, if you obey the words of Yahweh, you're going to live. So man live by the word. Alright now. Living word. Get the Genesis way up here.
Genesis 15:1.
Yes.
After these things, the word of Yahweh came unto Abram in a vision, saying.
So the word came unto Abram in a vision. Say.
Fear not.
So the word of speak. Fear not, Abram.
I am thy shield.
Yes.
And thy exceeding great reward.
And thy exceeding great reward. So this is the word, it's important to know what the know about this word here, and that's the living word. Yahweh, get us. Right? Now we're on the gospel, right? So we had Jonah. But we just come out because we just Jonah's the word of Yahweh gave out to me and say, read.
Now the word of Yahweh came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying,
yeah.
Arise. Go to Nineveh.
Yeah.
That great city.
Yes.
And cry against it.
Yeah.
For their wickedness is come up before me.
Yes.
But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish.
So Jonah never wanted to go anywhere. You understand me? Him flee to Tarshish. But all you ever run away from Yahweh. Yahweh's spirit, he may go everywhere. And David said, if you get the wings of the man and the atmosphere of the ear, Yahweh is here. If you lay bed again, Yahweh is here. If you go to the deepest spot, I see Yahweh is here. Where can I go from the presence of Yahweh? Because Yahweh is ever present. And the founder of a lecture about that ever presence of Yahweh. And if you understand that Yahweh is ever present, some of the things we don't want to do. You understand? Read.
Yeah. From the presence of Yahweh.
Yeah.
And went down to Joppa.
Yeah.
And he found a ship.
Yeah.
Going to Tarshish.
Yeah. And
he gained the fear thereof.
Except they go on going up.
And went down into it.
Yeah.
To go with them on the Tarshish from the presence of Yahweh. Jonah 1:4. But Yahweh sent out a great storm.
Oh, like,
great wind.
Oh, that put it. So Yahweh said, that's Tava for the body. You understand it? Read.
Into the sea.
Yeah.
And there was a mighty tempest in the sea.
Yeah.
So that the ship was like to be broken.
Yeah.
Then the mariners were afraid and cried, every man unto his mighty one,
yeah.
And cast forth the wares
that were in the ship. Send your ship out to breaks and start throw off things. And Judah tell him, say, take me up.
Into the sea.
Yeah, just touch it.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Mm. Verse 9.
Yes.
And Jonah said unto him,
yeah.
I am an Hebrew.
Yes.
And I fear
Yahweh. And I fear Yahweh.
The Elohim of heaven.
And some people fear. We can't be fear of Yahweh. Now watch. Some people, he said an Hebrew, some people get fierce. The last is find that scripture from him. 2 Peter. Get me? We know where we are. Peter now. Peter 2:1. When he said the last is perilous time shall come. Find that scripture.
This know also
that
in the last days.
And what the scripture calls it, the Spirit speak expressly. Since this know also.
But in the last days.
That in the last days.
Perilous times.
Perilous times shall come. Read.
For men shall be lovers of their own self.
Men shall be lovers of their own self. Now hold on. Just like in the spirit realm, you are war in heaven. And lose how want people to look at it. In other words, one of the other angels to look at it. And then take them start gaze from those from far, one third of them. So Yahweh used one third. Man, he might use mankind's soul to replenish that one third. Because there's a rebellion in heaven. Read.
Covetous.
Covetous.
Boasters.
Boasters.
Proud.
Proud. And Yahweh said, you're not a proud. That's in Proverbs. Read.
Blasphemer.
Blasphemers. And they blaspheme the name, the tabernacle. Blasphemers. Read.
Disobedient to parents.
Disobedient to Yahweh.
Unthankful.
Unthankful.
Unholy.
Unholy.
Without natural affection.
They do have natural affection.
Truth breakers.
Truth breakers. Now hold it. Truth breakers. When Yahweh set up these schools, through the founder, that's how the Charles Company School set up. They set up trustees. You look up trustees sometimes. They are supposed to, they've been trusted with the gospel to preach it just like how they get it. And look here, they become opposers to the things of disobedience to Yahweh. Because look here, Yahweh set up a school. Yahweh set up a school. Listen, you saw the school set up, through. It's the Holy Spirit, through the founder, set up a school.
Right.
Him set up a dean, him set up a president, him set up a secretary, him set up a congregation officer, him set up a superintendent, don't it? Him set up a dean, him set up a treasurer. And everybody's not the dean or the president or the treasurer. Yahweh give them specific responsibility. And just like Yahweh gave Adam the law, he never got to Eve, he's not in drive out Eve out of the garden. If Adam didn't give the law. So there's a responsibility go with these things. So what this you see, Yahweh set things in order. And sometimes we try to oppose it. It's not everybody's a secretary. You understand? It's not everybody's a congregation officer. Yeah, anything up, Yahweh got to who is set up. And it's in Hebrew, you know. We have said it despise our authority. You're going to find it in some
Second Timothy 2, verse 3, come.
Yeah.
Without natural affection.
Without natural affection. You can't follow natural laws. Read.
Truth breakers.
Truth breakers, we're talking about trustees, how you get to teach it. It's very few people teach it, how they get it. Because as I pass it, oh, I receive it, that's why I give it to you. Read.
False accusers.
False accusers.
Incontinent.
Yes.
Fierce,
that's what we're talking about. They have no respect for your authority. They have no respect for Yahweh. Elohim Yahshua, read.
Despisers of those that are good. Traitors.
And look at the verse sometime and see here, you say examine yourself. Don't it? Say, you know what, five pick up on the next spot. You say examine yourself and see you in the field. Read.
Heady.
High-minded.
Lovers of pleasures.
Lovers of pleasures. Read.
Having a form of righteousness.
People can repeat the name, eh? But it comes down to who the Holy Spirit is in. Because I can baptize in the name and do have the Holy Spirit. So they have a form of righteousness.
What can then the power thereof?
Yes.
From such turn away.
From such turn away. Read.
For of this sort,
yes,
are they which creep into houses.
Creep into houses.
And you captive silly women.
Yes. And you want to know what it's still about. And how they creep into houses. What is it tell you? You understand? If you don't pay attention and it's a crowd. You understand me? And if you don't pay attention, it's like getting to you. Read.
And lead captive silly women laden with sin.
Yeah.
Led away with diverse gusts.
Read.
Ever learning.
Hey, that's what you don't want. You don't want ever learning and not coming to the reality.
And never even come to the knowledge of the truth.
To the knowledge of the truth. Ever learning, but never come to the reality. Can't stand for something firm. Something unmovable. And Yahweh El Yashua, the knowledge of Yahweh El Yashua is forever. It's unmovable. You must unmovable in the field. Read.
2 Timothy 3, verse 8. Continue. Mm-hmm. Now, as Yannis and Yambres
withstood Moses. And listen, they think that Moses are withstood. Mm-hmm. And people try to fight up against the teacher. Pick up the curse, but really, you might be resisting and opposing the Holy Spirit in that vessel. Read. That's why when Yahweh knocked down Paul on the road to Damascus, he said, why don't persecutors don't be Paul? You understand me? Why? Because I pursued them with the Holy Spirit. So be careful of these things. The things you said. That's why David said, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be accepted in thy sight. Because Yahweh tried the heart. So you don't want a smiling face and a wicked heart towards Yahweh. Read.
Some of the others and the others understood Moses. Mm-hmm. So do these also resist the truth?
Yes.
Men of corrupt mind.
No, when you, Yahweh said, eternal life is no Yahshua. And the only name of salvation is Yahshua. And if you say the name is Kinley, you become corrupt.
Mm-hmm. Reprobate.
And you know what I'm saying? Reprobate.
Concerning the sin.
Yeah, and people do these things. You see them kind of same thing. And people try all sorts of things. But the whole name of salvation is Yahshua. And you know what Yahweh said about that? Romans 1, 9. Romans 1, read from about 20. Because they didn't want, they don't want to retain Yahweh in their knowledge.
Romans 1, and 20.
Yeah.
For the invisible things of Him, from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Yes.
We understood that the things that are made, even His eternal power and supreme nature, so that they are.
Say God excuse, can say inexcusable, man. Read.
Because that when they knew Yahweh.
That when, say about how people know Him. He said that when they knew Yahweh.
Yahweh Elohim.
Yes.
They glorified Him not as Yahweh.
They don't glorify Him as Yahweh Elohim.
Neither were thankful.
Neither were they thankful.
But became vain in their
imagination. They become vain in their imagination because Yahweh said all imagination of man is wickedness before Him.
And their foolish hearts were dark.
And Yahweh darkened their hearts. Their foolish hearts were dark.
Professing themselves to be wise.
They profess themselves to be wise.
They became.
But when they speak, and the Holy Spirit in you recognize what they are saying, they become fools. Read.
And change the glory of the uncorruptible
Elohim
into an image.
Into an image.
Made like uncorruptible.
That's the master that needs to kill the salvation and all that thing. Into an image. Read. And this man has a couple of lectures now. We read them, right?
Into an image.
And he said he's not the Savior. And he said that many times. And people say them love Dr. Shinley, right? People say them love Dr. Clinton, but then why they don't preach them preach? Mm-hmm. Read.
Into an image. Like unto corruptible
man. Read.
And to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things.
Yeah.
Wherefore, Yahweh gave them up to uncleanness.
Yahweh gave them up to uncleanness. And said, give them a delusion. And let them believe it, that it might damn them.
Through the lust of their own hearts.
Read.
To dishonor their own bodies between themselves.
Read.
Who change the truth of Yahweh into a
lie. Into a lie.
And worship and serve the creature more than the creator.
Who is blessed forevermore. Read.
Blessed forever.
Read.
For this cause Yahweh gave them up unto vile affections.
Yes.
For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature.
Yeah.
And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the women, burnt in their lust, one toward another. Men with men, working that which is unseen, and receiving in themselves the recompense of their error that was in. And even as they did not like to retain Yahweh in their knowledge.
They don't like, they don't want to retain Yahweh in their knowledge. You listen to lecture of some of them 2 or 3 hours and then I mention Yahweh and Yahshua.
Yahweh.
What does that mean? They don't want to retain Yahshua and their knowledge. Read.
Yahweh gave them all.
So because I cannot retain them to become a reprobate mind. Look up that verse sometime. Read.
And to do those things which are not convenient.
Read.
Being filled with all unrighteousness.
Unrighteousness.
Fornication.
Fornication.
Wickedness.
Wickedness.
Covetousness.
Covetousness.
Maliciousness.
Yes.
Full of envy.
Yeah, the murder, envy for the good people. Read.
Murder.
Murder.
Debate.
Because you, listen, if you preach any other name other from Yahshua the Messiah for salvation, and preach any other name, and people believe it, you're murdering people's souls.
Full of envy.
Read.
Murder.
Mm-hmm.
Debate.
Debate, as always, argument.
Deceit.
Deceit.
Malignity.
Read.
Whisperers.
Whisperers.
Backbiters.
Backbiters. Read.
Haters of Yahweh.
Haters of Yahweh.
Despiteful.
Yes.
Proud.
Yes.
Boasters.
Yes.
Inventors of evil things.
Inventors of evil things. That's how you get a birdstone. And all them foolish. You understand? They invent things.
Disobedient to parents.
Disobedient to Yahweh. Read.
Without understanding.
Without understanding.
Covenant breakers.
Read.
Without natural affection.
Read.
Implacable.
Yes.
Unmerciful.
And them words are reading. Look them up sometimes for yourself. In fact, they don't have no mercy.
Who knowing the judgment of Yahweh.
Yes.
That they which commit such things
deserve
worthy of death. Not only do the same.
But not only do the same.
But have pleasure.
But have pleasure.
In them that do
that you, in other words, you're consent to it. It's like the one who do it. Say no one here, they wrote us down to the other side, but no, you have to defend the gospel. You understand? Because that's where we handle the gospel. Yahweh, when you know these things. And what will happen to you if you continue that way? You understand me? Alright, now, get it. Jonah, now. So Jonah was shown him about that's dead. You understand me? Young people are great fish, is full of Jonah, that's burial. That's death burial. 3 days after he resurrected, the fish vomited out on dry land. You understand me? So that's death burial, resurrection. You understand me? He said, lean as a man is this man, you know, there's blood. That's blood. The sea's water, blood water. And Yahweh's spirit talked to the fish, that blood water spirit. I said, 40 days and then the fish shall leave. This overthrow. You understand me? So it's a principle. And a principle is a law unchangeable. You understand me? So it's a principle. So we're going to get Yahshua himself now. Because Yahshua, Matthew 16 and 15, when 16:19, in preaching more gospel, can say, I must go to Jerusalem. Mr. Mitchell, I must go to Jerusalem.
16:19.
Yeah, come back. Matthew 16. Yeah.
And from that time
and
forth,
from that time forth
began Yahshua to show unto his disciples how that he must go up to Jerusalem. And suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes.
Yes.
And be killed.
And be killed.
And be raised again.
Be killed. How we do that dead man? You went to bury. That's dead. Burial. Resurrection. We raise again. Right?
The third, right?
Same preacher more in gospel. And then Peter take him, right? And say, shall that not go up to you? In other words, but Yahshua, you can't deceive those in the womb. Those like, just like how from that God, he said that. You shall not die. You understand? You tell him that she shall not. You understand? Yahweh said, you're going to die for your food. Then he said, no, you shall not. So that word is but it was put not here. And we are chopping all the way down dispensation and ages. Him always be our poser. So Yahweh said, to get me there, you see. You understand? Right? We can recognize the spirit. You understand? Because one of two spirits I will speak to you. It's either the righteous spirit or the unrighteous spirit. I will have two. You understand? And two spirits can have body. It's one of them over here. Right?
Alright. At the same time.
At the same time. Alright. You're doing it. Alright. Get me Yahshua now. Matthew 27 and 5.
Chapter 27.
Yeah.
Yahshua. When he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up his spirit.
He said, the spirit come out of the body permanently, you're dead. So Yahshua died. Read.
Verse 57.
Yes.
When the evening was come, There came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph.
Yes.
Who also himself was Yahshua's disciple.
Yeah, he was a far off disciple, but he was Yahshua's disciple, read.
He went to Pilate and begged the body of Yahshua.
Think about this man, his spirit, soul, and body. So he went and begged the body of Yahshua. Yes, I'm out. Where was the spirit? Now I get it, Peter. 1 Peter 3 and about 18, it tells you it was in the spirit realm. Just like we know, so the sun on this side now, as straight as the sun is there, it's on the other side. You understand me? So he said, he's not here, so he begged the body of Yahshua. Read that.
For Yahshua the Messiah,
yeah,
also hath once suffered for sins.
Yes.
The just
body
for the unjust.
Read.
That he might bring us to Yahweh.
Yes.
Being put to death in the flesh,
read,
but quickened by the Spirit. 1 Peter 3, verse 19.
Mm-hmm.
By which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison.
Because we have some who died believing in Yahweh and Yahshua, you understand? Mm-hmm. But they could not resurrect because it's the first fruit of them that resurrect. So they must resurrect after him resurrect. So they go back to them now. Like Job who said, I know that my Redeemer liveth. And when it go back to them in the spirit realm, go back and carry them themselves. You understand? Why? Because that to them that was before, them that is right present and them that be in the future. You understand? So he picked them up. Right? So it was in the spirit realm. And they recognize him too. They recognize him too, so he is Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
Because the spirit realm is more active, and the agent is more active than the natural. If Yahshua just move your flesh, just like you close your eyes, walk black your flesh. But Yahshua just move and see how much angels. You understand me? The only the truth. Read?
Yes. Which sometimes
yeah.
were disobedient.
Which sometimes were disobedient.
When once the long suffering of Yahweh waited in the days of Noah.
In the days of Noah.
While the ark
was preparing.
Wherein two, that is eight
souls,
were right, saved by water.
We have 5 minutes. So we get Yahshua now. So we get him died. He was buried, Joseph knew too. You understand? So that's death burial. You understand? Resurrected. Walked to the body when he was in the tomb. The body was consumed. It never see corruption. You understand? They find that Yahshua resurrected. And resurrected that quickening spirit. Matthew 5, 28, 5 and 6.
Matthew 28, verse
yeah.
5. And the angel answered and said unto the widow,
he is not here.
Fear not ye. For I know that ye seek Yahshua,
yeah.
which was crucified. He is not here. For he is risen.
As he said.
Come see the place where Yahshua lay.
Yeah, so Yahshua is resurrected. Get me 1 Corinthians 15, 1 to 4. You understand? And get me Galatians 1. And read on though. Yeah.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you
the gospel
which I preach unto you,
yes,
which also ye have received,
yes,
and wherein you stand,
yes,
by which also you are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preach unto you,
yes,
unless ye have believed in vain.
Yes.
For I delivered unto you first of all,
yes,
that which I also received.
Oh.
That Yahshua died for us
is according to the scripture.
And that he was buried.
He died. And that he was buried.
That he rose again.
And he rose again the third day
according to the scripture.
He knows they didn't wait because they are according to the scripture. So he was going to die. You understand me? Alright, now give me Galatians now. Yeah.
Galatians chapter 1.
And the everlasting gospel. You understand me? First, Revelation 1. And 14 and 6.
Galatians 1, verse 6.
Yeah.
I marvel that ye are so soon removed.
No, this is of Christ speaking to
you. From him that called
him. That did not call him. Says, see a calling virgin, not many mighty men.
Into
not many noble. But Joshua called him, that is true. Read.
Galatians,
but many are called, but very few are chosen. Read.
Galatians 1, 6 continues.
Yeah.
Move from him that called him.
Yeah.
Into the grace of Yahshua the Anointed One, unto another gospel.
Read, unto another gospel.
Which is not another.
Read that gossip, because they preach another. Listen, Yahshua said, go in here for and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believe it, and he that
believe
it,
shall be baptized.
And is baptized shall be saved. He that believe it, that shall be done. So instead of preach the gospel, read. and set every creed.
But there be some that trouble you,
yeah,
and would pervert the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah.
Yes.
But don't we are an
agent from heaven? Don't we are an agent from heaven?
Preach any other gospel.
Preach any other gospel. Don't you know the gospel tell them? That Yahshua died, he was buried, and he resurrected again, the third day, with the peace of blood, water, spirit, Father. Because when he pierced him inside, out came blood and water. And he gave up the spirit of blood, water, spirit, and he had earth in Father. Read.
Then that which we have preached,
which we have preached unto you,
let him be
a third. Read.
As we said before, so say
I now again. Yes.
If any man, preach any other
gospel
unto you,
yes,
than that which we have received,
yes,
ye have received,
yes,
let him be a curse.
Let him be a curse, for then I receive it up.
For do I now persuade men,
yes,
or Yahweh,
yeah,
or do I seek to please men? For if I get pleased,
I
shall not be the servant of Yahshua the Messiah.
Yahshua the Messiah. You understand? You look here, get my collotion at the bed now, right? Get my collotion. You have a pea grain in your hand. You know, I get like pea. You look fine just a week. We send a bird to the bird in the earth. So that's death, burial, 3 years after the resurrection. You understand me? So that's death, burial, resurrection. You understand me? That's the gospel. You understand? So you're not trying to understand the spirit. You understand? I remember this, that Yahshua, he's resurrected. I'm supposed to resurrect on your heart and mind. And if you, and listen, if Yahshua, if Yahshua the Messiah resurrected in you, or Yahshua in you, any at all, or the Holy Spirit in you, you shall not be deceived. There must be a change that takes place. Some people say, well, I can stay a long time, something wrong. But the gospel supposed to be changing you. You understand it? So you must see the change. And Yahshua said, when light and lamp, you don't put another bed. Everybody can see. You don't have to tell everybody, say, oh, me change. They can't see the change within you. You understand? Just like the Moses come down here, they could have seen change. Like those who shone and shine, and then can see that in you. Just like how Colossians. Just like the people. You know, somebody come across one time and said they're going to a beautiful pattern. You understand? And the phone is going to be most beautiful. Okay, in here. We call the wood for the damage. Yes, but it's a beauty shine on the outside. You understand me? So it's a difference when you have the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit and you have the Holy Spirit in you that when it goes in you. You understand? Even the mystery. Which has been
the mystery which hath been hidden from ages and from generations,
yes,
but now is made manifest
to his son,
to whom Yahweh,
yes, will make it known, Yahweh make it known,
what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the nations.
What is it?
Which is Yahshua,
Yahshua Messiah in you.
Your only hope.
That's your only hope of glory.
Whom we preach, warning every man,
yes,
and teaching every man in all wisdom,
yes,
that we may present every man perfect in Yahshua.
And let Yahshua Messiah work in you mightily. All praise go to Yahweh and Yahshua. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Just sit there, keep your eyes on the monitor. Do not look at me. And just follow the moving speaker. Good evening, class. I appreciate the first speaker and he laid a good foundation. I'd like to try to get two birds with one stone if I can. I'm going to springboard off the things he said and try to tie in a couple other things together. Now, the first speaker was talking about Jonah, okay? And let's just read that. I think it's the last part of the second chapter. Start from there. Because these things have to be fulfilled, right? Because if it's established in the law and the prophets, then Yahshua has to fulfill it. Or he has to be performed in some kind of way. Okay? Now, I need glasses now. Chapter 2, maybe like... Okay, let's start with, five.
Yes, five.
Yes.
The waters compassed me about, even to the soul. The depth closed me round about. the winds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the bottoms of the mountains. The earth, with her bars, was about me forever.
Okay, now, the past about him, I mean, he was trapped in this fish. The fish is a type of the grave, see, or Sheol, as they say in Hebrew. There's no such place as hell. That's a Greek connotation, you know, with the fire and all like that. The real connotation is Sheol, which is the grave. Okay, continue reading.
Yes, Joel, chapter 2, verse 6 continues. Yet hast thou brought up my life from the from corruption, O Yahweh my Elohim. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered Yahweh, and my prayer came in unto thee, into thy holy temple. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice unto thee the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of Yahweh.
Yahshua. That's what he said. Yahshua. Read.
And Yahshua spake unto the fish. Yahweh spake unto the fish. And it vomited out Joel upon the dry land.
Continue.
Jonah, chapter 3, verse 1. The word of Yahweh came unto Jonah the second time, saying, Arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I have bid thee. So Jonah rose and went unto Nineveh according to the word of Yahweh. Now, Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey.
Now, do you know what that means? See, that means this. The city of Nineveh was so big that if you were to walk around it, it would take you 3 days to walk around it. That's how big the city was. This is an ancient city. This city was built by Nimrod. So you can go back and see, because we're in the prophecy now. They say, well, what's it say about Nineveh in the law of Moses? Well, Nimrod built it. That's what it said, because you can go back and read that. Maybe we should read that. But keep your finger there and get Genesis 10 and 8. See, because we want to get law prophecy fulfillment in this. We want to show the witnesses and then show Yahshua fulfilling.
Genesis 10 and 8. And Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before Yahweh. Wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod the mighty hunter before Yahweh.
Or against Yahweh. See, when they say that before Yahweh, people think, oh, he's standing in front of it. That's not what that means. That means he is against Yahweh. Okay, continue.
At the beginning of the kingdom was Babel and Ebrek and Calneh in the land of Shinar. Out of that land went for Asher and built Nineveh.
And he built Nineveh. Nimrod was the one who built the city of Nineveh. And see, and let me tell you something from a historical point of view. The historians used to think that the city of Nineveh was a fable. They thought it didn't exist. Until they found the archaeological remains. And when they began to dig it up, they was kept digging and digging. They was like, holy moly, this is a big place. With suburbs and all this, I mean, it just said 3 days. In other words, the city was so big, it would take you 3 days to walk around it. It was a metropolitan, it was an ancient metropolitan city. With trade and goods and people, all kinds of people that were there. And it was a wicked city. It was wicked when Nimrod built it. It was wicked now. At this time, we're with Jonah, okay? Go back to Jonah.
Chapter 3
and
4.
That's
verse 4.
Yes, we're here.
And Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey.
After a day's journey, because see, remember, we read that the fish spit him out on the land. And Yahweh just, you know, after it took, look, Nineveh, look, you'll hear on the map,
Here's where he spit him out. Jonah had to go a long way inland, but it took him only a day. Why did it take him a day? Remember back here when the Israelites came through the divided waters of the Red Sea? What did Yahweh say? I bore you on eagle's wings. See, they just zoom right on in there. See, Yahweh bore them on eagle's wings. Same way for Jonah. Yahweh just bore him on and got in there in one day. Okay? Go ahead.
All right. And he cried and said, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown.
And then after his death, after Jonah's death, burial, resurrection, then he appears in Nineveh and he says, after 40 days, Nineveh will be overthrown. Mm-hmm. See, it's going by the pattern. Death, burial, resurrection, 40. Okay? Now, I'm going to expedite this because it will say that the king, and they all repented. They, you know, wore sackcloth and all like that, and that was great. Only problem was, it only lasted 100 years. Because you can go and read in the book of Nahum, when Nineveh did get destroyed. See?
Yeah.
All right? Now, here's the thing about it. We're talking about Jonah. So now, we found in the law, Nineveh. Now we find in the prophecy about Nineveh, but now we want to get to the fulfillment. I think it's John the 21st chapter. That's what we want. Yes, 21 and 1.
John 21:1.
Mm-hmm.
And these things Yahshua showed him. After these things,
mm-hmm.
Yahshua showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias.
Mm-hmm.
And on this wise showed he himself. There were together Simon Peter and
mm-hmm.
Thomas, called Didymus, and Nathanael
mm-hmm.
of Cana in Galilee,
mm-hmm.
and of the sons of Zebedee, and the two other of his disciples. Simon Peter said unto them,
mm-hmm.
I go a fishing.
Mm-hmm.
They say unto him, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into the ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing.
Okay, now, there's seven of them. There's seven fishing, seven of the disciples, they're going fishing. And they're fishing at night. Okay? Now, see, this is the post-Diluvian age. Now, from Adam on down is darkness. Because death reigned over Adam, over mankind, for 4,000 years until the coming of Joshua. So they're in the dark. Now, Peter and the boys, they're fishing at night. Comparatively speaking, they're fishing, here's the cross here. They're fishing on this side of the cross, and they caught nothing, okay? Because there's no, how can I put it, there's nothing here. They caught nothing. Continue reading.
But when the morning was now come,
uh-huh.
Yahshua stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Yahshua.
See, now, Yahshua's on the shore. This is in the morning. And he's on the shore, and he's waiting for them. Read.
Then Yahshua said unto them, children, have ye any meat?
They caught any meat? Read.
They answered him, no.
No, we didn't catch anything all during the night. Post-Diluvian age, all during the night. We didn't catch a thing. Read.
And he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship.
Now, cast the net on the right side of the ship. I'm pointing this way because it's on the right side. Looking at this chart, it's on the right side of the cross. So cast your net on the right side of the ship.
And ye shall find.
And you'll find. Why? Because it's a type and shadow of a spiritual age, a spiritual dispensation. Read.
They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
Therefore, that disciple who Yahshua loved said unto Peter, it is the Master.
Mm-hmm.
Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Master, he girt his fisher's coat onto him, for he was naked, and did cast himself into the sea.
Now he jumped into the sea. Why did he do that? What was Simon Peter's real name? Y'all know? His name was Simon Bar Jonah. That was his name, Simon Bar Jonah, son of Jonah. So just as Jonah was cast into the sea, here's a fulfillment. Peter got to jump into the sea. Because this is a fulfillment of, this, of what's happening with Jonah. Read.
After the disciples came in a little ship, for they were not far from land, but as it were 200 cubits, dragging the net with fishes. As soon as they were come to the land, they saw a fire of coals there, and fish laid upon thereon, and bread.
Okay, now fish laid. Now Yahshua had a fish on coals, a prepared fish. That Yahshua didn't go fishing. We don't read anything about Yahshua got a fishing pole and going out. You understand? Yahshua had a fish prepared right there on the coals. Why? Because Yahweh, remember back here, prepared a fish for Jonah. You get it? All right? Continue.
Yahshua said unto them, Bring the fish which we have now caught.
Mm-hmm.
Simon Peter went up and drew the net to land full of great fishes,
153 fishes, that's what they caught on this side. Now, what does that stand for? Well, the 50, see, we got Pentecost here. Pentecost is a Greek word. The word pente in Greek means 50. Why? Because the day of Pentecost happened 50 days after Yahshua's resurrection. Yahshua, during his ministry was 3.5 years. He celebrated 3 Pentecosts during his ministry. 3 times 50 is 150. And then he went through a death, burial, resurrection, or that is to say, 3 days in the heart of the earth. So that adds up to 153. Okay? Now that's what that's showing that in that, the direct fulfillment. Now here's even a more extended fulfillment. It's not up here, but if you get this little map, it'll show you. See, let's see that, yeah. Because it'll show you two dotted lines that go here. One is Jonah's journey, and the other one was Peter's journey to Nineveh. See, because he went to Nineveh, and Jonah went, Jonah went to Nineveh, but Peter went to Babylon, okay? He went to Babylon. Now, see, if you look at this image here, see, it was necessary for Simon Bar-Jonah to repeat the first Jonah's journey because Nineveh and Babylon are in the same geographical location. Now, when you look at it like this, with this image up here, that would be the head of this image. So here you got Peter going here after Simon Bar-Jonah's trek, which would be at the head of this image, Nebuchadnezzar's dream. Paul, he ends up at the feet, because he ends up at Rome. See, he's striking at the feet.
Yeah.
In the middle, right here in the Aegean Sea, we got John on the island of Patmos. So here you got Peter hitting in the head, John got him in the middle, and Paul got him at the feet. And what do you have? The destruction. See, you got the apostles were setting up the kingdom of heaven and tearing down the kingdom of Satan by their preaching. See? Now, saying that, Yahshua is showing that this rock that was cut out of the mountain without hands, according to Nebuchadnezzar's dream, had to be, that is the preaching, and that's Yahshua himself, because see, look here. Oh boy, I gotta put this. Revelation 13:1. Because see, if you remember Nebuchadnezzar's dream, see, he dreamed of a head of gold, arms of silver, waist of brass, legs of iron, feet made of part iron, part clay, and a great rock was cut out of the mountain without hands, that shattered it at his feet. See?
Revelation 13:1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns.
Read.
And upon his horns, ten crowns, and upon his head the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power, and his seat, and great authority. And I saw one of his heads, and it were wounded to death.
That's it. Now, how can you wound the devil to death? Who, let me ask you this. What human being has the power to wound the devil to death? No one. Only Yahshua. That's John looking back on Nebuchadnezzar's dream, and he's confirming what Daniel is revealing to Nebuchadnezzar about this rock cut out of the mountain, cut out of the hand, and it struck this image. And see, and it was a deadly wound. So see, that's manifesting him at the cross. Because here we got kingdom of Satan abolished, kingdom of Yahweh restored. That rock was the Messiah. That was the deadly wound inflicted upon the beast. See, but read.
And I saw one of the heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed.
And his deadly wound was healed. Read.
And all the world wondered after the beast.
And the whole world wondered after the beast. And they marveled at it. See, because Satan, how can I put this? Let's get Revelations 20. Yeah, Revelation 20.
Verse 1?
Yes.
Revelation chapter 20. Verse 1.
And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit, and a great chain in his hand.
Now, what key are we talking about? And what great chain is, what is the material, or what is the great chain that could lay hold on this devil, or this beast, or this dragon? See? The key is the power. That's the key. Because this is going to unlock or lock anything. This is the key to everything. Now, the great chain, what is the great chain that's going to bind this beast? See? Here it is. These dispensations. This is a great chain. These dispensations are like links in a chain. See, look here. This first dispensation, this is called the Adamic dispensation. This came about here, when you have the Garden of Eden. This is in the first age of the creative age. See, when Adam was placed in the midst of the garden, it was reflected by the sun being placed in the midst of the sky. Both suns are synonymous. See? When Adam died in his consciousness, the sun, I'm talking about the S-U-N, began to move toward darkness. Why? It was a reflection of the man's consciousness going into darkness. This is where time began, here. And the man was kept. Look here. Right here. This is the creative age right here, which is the same as this right here. Now, when the transgression happened, both suns are moving down together. And here's this angel here. Now, see the sun set here? The sun is setting, or it's getting dark, reflecting the man's consciousness, going into darkness. And they're being cast into the outer darkness. Here you got this angel with a flaming sword. He's showing them the egress. And they are walking out of the creative age and walking into the darkness of the antediluvian age. That's the Adamic dispensation. Because a dispensation can close an age, it also can open an age. Now, this dispensation lasted until Yahweh commissioned another man. Now, mind you, Adam lived 930 years. But that's not the length of the Adamic dispensation, because when he physically died, I'm talking about Adam, that dispensation continued on until Yahweh chose Noah. So there were things that happened in the Adamic dispensation after Adam's death that was not in the Noahic dispensation, such as the birth and the translation of Enoch. That happened 57 years after the death of Adam. but it was in the Adamic dispensation prior to Noah. Now when Noah comes along, Yahweh says, okay, 120 years, and that's it for man. See, that's a dispensation, and that dispensation, which brought about the flood, closed that age and opened the post-diluvian age. So these dispensations are like links in a chain. See, that's why I say this great chain that Yahshua, because it's an angel who comes down that's doing this. See, it's Yahshua that's doing it, because he's the only one that has the power of the key and this chain. See, it was brought up about the spirits being preached, and that Yahshua spoke to the spirits in prison. See, and I grew up in church, and I remember my godfather was the preacher of the church, by the way. And I used to ask him some hard questions for a kid, because I remember seeing a picture. They had a lithograph of Jesus Christ walking down some steps, and his hand was glowing with light, and he was talking to those spirits in prison. And that's how Christianity looks at it. But what the real deal is this. The Holy Spirit was speaking to all these spirits in prison. I'm talking about the Holy Spirit through Adam, through Noah, through Melchizedek, I mean Abraham. See, the Holy Spirit was preaching in all these dispensations to the spirits in prison, because they were dead in their consciousness in a physical body. So they were in the grave walking around dead, but the Holy Spirit preached to them. Just like it was brought out by the previous speakers. Job said, I know my Redeemer liveth, and I will see him at the latter day. Why? Because he was dead in prison when Yahshua and his life appeared to him and preached to him. And he said, I know my Redeemer liveth. I'll see him. He was one of those spirits trapped in prison. All of them were, until Yahshua Messiah's death, death, burial, resurrection. See? So this is the great chain that binds Satan. The last chain, see, the seventh dispensation, when that link comes along and Satan is bound up, then we in Yahshua will give him the collective boot into the lake of fire. Bound. This is the chain that binds him. The seven dispensations. Okay, Revelation. Wherever you at?
Revelation, chapter 24. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit, and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is called the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years.
And bound him 1,000 years. See, now, go ahead.
Cast him into the bottomless pit.
And cast him into the bottomless pit. Go ahead.
And shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more.
Now, this is what's happening here. Yahshua Messiah, on his death, burial, resurrection. When Yahshua resurrected, see, that was a vision. And see, the satanic spirit and all these demons, they were incarnated in the Sanhedrin Council, the 70 elders. And when that day happened, when Yahshua resurrected, he didn't resurrect by himself. He had an army behind him. See, and they walked into Jerusalem and were seen by many in a vision. You know, somebody, just keep your finger in Revelation, we're still going back and again. 1 Corinthians 15:3. Because see, they were seen by me in a vision.
1 Corinthians 15:3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. How that Yahshua died for our sins, according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of about 500 brethren at once.
They all saw him in a vision. But now, while that happening with them, the Sanhedrin Council, of whom those satanic spirits were incarnated in, they sequestered themselves in the temple, and they did not come out that whole day. While Yahshua and those, because when they saw, they didn't see just Yahshua in a vision, because we told you he didn't resurrect by himself. They saw people, they saw Yahshua coming. Those who believed that, it's the ones who didn't believe, they didn't see nothing. But those who believed, They saw Yahshua in a vision coming to the city. They saw Adam, they saw Noah, they saw Moses, they saw Jeremiah. They saw John the Baptist. They saw everybody who died in the faith, resurrected and walked in the city and walked around Jerusalem like everybody else. But the scribes and Pharisees, they were sequestered up in the temple, huddled up in the temple. You know, they said, no, we ain't going out there to deal with this. We're not going to deal with that. See, they were bound in that temple for that one day. And look, for 1,000 years, because see, when you talk about time, see, we went over this last night a little bit. See, you got prophetic time, which is a day for a year, and a year for a day. That's called prophetic time. Then you have creative time, or that is to say, time with Yahweh Elohim. That is 1,000 years is as one day, and one day is as 1,000 years. Then you have, that would be in the holy place. Then you have the day of Yahweh, which there's no beginning and no end. Time begins and ends within the realm of eternity. So now when we talk about 1,000 years, that one day, which is like 1,000 years, that was the one day Satan was bound. Continue. Yeah.
And that he was buried, and as he rose again.
No, I want Revelation. I won't go back to Revelation, I'm sorry.
Revelation 20.
I'm sorry.
And verse.
Nine.
He said, and they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the sons above.
Where are you at?
Revelation 20, verse 9.
Did we get that far? Did we get that far?
God, Father? For the breadth of the earth.
Start with three again. Just start with three.
Revelation 20, verse 3. Casting into the bottomless pit.
Mm-hmm. The bottomless pit. Go ahead.
And shut him up.
Mm-hmm.
And set a seal upon him.
Mm-hmm.
That he should deceive the nations no more. Till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled.
Yeah, all right. Till that day was finished. Okay, go ahead.
And after that, he must be loosed a little season. And I saw thrones,
mm-hmm.
and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded
mm-hmm.
for the witness of Yahshua,
mm-hmm.
and for the word of Yahweh, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands,
mm-hmm.
and they lived and reigned with Yahshua the Messiah 1,000 years.
That for that day, with Yahshua resurrected, and all those who died in the faith, they resurrected with him and went into the city, and they reigned for that day, or 1,000 years, which is as one day. Mm-hmm. Continue.
Revelation 20, verse 5. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished.
Now the rest of the dead didn't live again until the 1,000 years were finished. In other words, they didn't live again until the day of Pentecost. See? Read.
This is the first resurrection.
Uh-huh.
Blessed and holy is he that took part in the first resurrection.
The first resurrection. Continue.
On such, the second death hath no part.
Now the second death has no part in that. Why? Because see, the second death, see, you can die physically, and you can be dead spiritually. But now, once you are raised spiritually, then the second death, which is going to be the universal revelation of Yahshua Messiah, that will not affect you if you are part of the first resurrection. The second death, which is the universal revelation, for those not in Yahshua, that will not affect you. Continue.
But they shall be priests of Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
and of Yahshua the Messiah, and they shall reign with him 1,000 years. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison.
Now he's going to be, in other words, the next day, those scribes and Pharisees, they came out of the temple, and they said, hey, you know what? They stole that body. That's what they did. They stole that body. See? They came out alive. See? Because remember, they had to pay these guys off. See, these soldiers, See, they were caught sleeping. And look, I'm ex-military myself. And one of the most cardinal rules in the military is this. You do not sleep on watch. There are severe, even during peacetime, there are some severe repercussions if you fall asleep on watch. If you fall asleep during wartime, that's the death penalty. You can get the death penalty for that because they say, you know, you fall asleep on watch and we're in a war zone, the enemy can walk up in here and you up here. And back here with these guys, these were Romans. And they didn't, and look, the Roman army was one of the most disciplined armies in history. And they didn't take no grub. You know, you didn't make the same mistake twice. And something like that, that's why you read the scriptures. They was begging the people. I said, look, you know, you got to talk to our superior because we're going to get punished real badly, you know, about this. And the scribes and the Pharisees said, look, don't worry. We will pay these people. And they had to pay off some big money. They said, we will secure you. You know, in other words, they had to pay them off so that, you know, they wouldn't get killed and so that the two soldiers that fell asleep, that they can help perpetuate the story. Yeah, we fell asleep and his disciples came and stole him while we fell asleep on watch. See? Just a lie. Continue.
Revelation 20, verses 7 and 8. And when the thousand years were finished, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters. Gog and Magog.
Gog and Magog are the leader and his people from the north.
Together.
That's what that means. Because Gog means leader and Magog means people. Why? Because it says that in Isaiah 14, where it says that Satan says, I will dwell in the sides of the north. See? What do you mean? Well, see, on the north side of this tabernacle, see, you got the tribe of Dan with the emblem on here. See, and he was, see, this is east, west, south, north. I will dwell on the sides of the north. And Dan was the one with the ensign, and the word Dan means the judge. So what he was really saying is, I'm going to be sitting in the judgment seat. That's what he's saying. Okay, continue.
Gog and Magog, gather them together to battle. The number of whom is as the sand of the sea.
And the sands of the seas and the stars of heaven, which is innumerable. Why? Because if you remember the story, when there was war in heaven, the dragon took his tail and drew one-third of the stars, or one-third of that heavenly host. Now, I said it drew his tail, which is T-A-I-L. But when you think about it, it was his tail, T-A-L-E, or his lie that he told in those days. Here I am, I'm your salvation. And one-third of an innumerable host of angels followed him. Now, if you read in the textbook, there's a section in the third volume where it talks about birth control. And Dr. Kinley had it written in there that when Satan drew that one-third of the angels from him, you know, from the angelic host, it was as if though they never exist. In other words, what you're looking at, when he drew them, that was like mass murder. On a scale that is inconsistent. Wait a minute. You know, you hear about people, you know, like Hitler, you know, and Stalin, and Pol Pot, and some other guys, you know, Idi Amin, all that, how they killed millions of people. That ain't nothing compared to this guy. Here's Satan, he has slaughtered one-third of an innumerable host of angels.
In the sky.
See? It's murder on a scale that's just inconceivable. It says he was a liar and a murderer from the beginning. The beginning of what? In the beginning of the angelic creation. He was lying and murdering even then, before there was even a physical creation. And then when a physical creation came and he was cast out here, what do you think he's going to do here? He's going to lie and murder. Read.
Yes. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the sons about and the camp about and the beloved city, and fire came down from Yahweh out of heaven and devoured them, and the dead that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before Yahweh.
This is the universal revelation we're talking about here. Again, she didn't know that. Continue.
Yes. Revelation, chapter 20, verse 12, continue. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death.
Now, this is the second death. But what did we read earlier? That if you skip that, if you get in the first resurrection, you are not subject to the second death. And listen, we're here in the age of Pentecost. Spiritual dispensation and a spiritual age. We're still in heaven. If you get in this resurrection before the second death is manifested, then you won't be subject to that second death either. That's what part of the gospel was being preached. So that we could tell people the good news is that one, you're not under Adam's transgression anymore. You're not under that law anymore, that you've been freed from that transgression, that death, and Yahshua has given you life. See, he's made you resurrect out of that state. And if you're resurrected out of that state, then you're not subject to the second death. However, if you don't get resurrected, hey, that second death, it'll be waiting for you. And nobody will be exempt from that if you're not in that resurrection. See? Now, this kingdom, we talked about these kingdoms, these satanic kingdoms. And they, look, these are universal dynasties. Now, there's more kingdoms there on the earth because, I mean, you hear about like different empires, you know, like Genghis Khan or Shaka Zulu or whatever, you know. People say, how come you don't study them? And all that, you know, or the Incas and the Mayas, you know. I said, well, I'll tell you why. Because, see, these are universal dynasties. And the civilization that we live in now that's predominant on the earth is what is called Western civilization, or what we call the Western tradition. See, because when you start looking at the Western tradition, you start going back into history, you know, like going back into the Reformation and the Renaissance and all that, and then you're going to wind up being with, you know, looking at Papal Rome, the history of the papacy, which in turn got its power from pagan Rome, which goes back to the Greeks, see, and Alexander the Great, which goes back to the Persians, Cyrus, Darius, and Artaxerxes, which goes back to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, which was the second Babylonian empire, which is derived from the first Babylonian empire, which is here, the Tower of Babel. And then goes back to the city of Enoch, built by Cain in the Antediluvian Age, which was the first, look, when you talk about these globalists and globalists, look, Cain was the first globalist, because he conquered the world in the Antediluvian Age, and his family ran for 1656 years. And Yahweh said that the mind of man was evil continually. Because this was a dynasty. And this is how these governments come about. Now, let me get this. Man, we're still in Revelations, aren't we? We can get at this.
Revelation 20, verse 15.
No, wait. There's just another chapter I want. I want 17 chapter. I'll start with one. And listen. This is not a scripture quoting contest, and I don't, you know, I mean, I can quote, but you have to understand the stories. That's why a lot of times I have passages read, because for the simple reason, most people don't read the Bible for some reason, you know, they don't, and so I try to do this so that you can be acquainted with what's in the Bible, and then we can show you up here on the chart what it's really saying, or what it really means. This is the thing our founder tried to do, because he was a bibliomaniac, he knew the Bible back and forward. But when he received this great panoramic vision and revelation, even he had to admit the Bible didn't read the same anymore. Because he's looking at it through the eyes of Yahweh, who is a divine, who is a universal spirit pattern with a universal law of the spirit embedded therein. Okay? And he's controlling everything. And that includes the adversary. The adversary, Satan, is not a free moral agent. He is controlled and operated by spirit law, just as you are, just as this whole universe is, bar nothing. So this thing like, oh, well, you know, because that's how Christianity comes up here when they say, well, Adam messed up, he in the garden, because Christianity looked at it like as if God put them there, and then, you know, it was paradise and all, and then they had a commandment, don't touch the tree in the midst of the garden, and they did, and then from Christianity's point of view, it was like God must have said, well, what do you know about that? Don't go and shut up. What could you do? I gave this guy a plum job. I mean, it wasn't that much. All I had to do was just pull a few weeds here and there. You know, I had all the fruit there. You know, I mean, you didn't lack for anything. I mean, the way the founder talked about it, he said when it was in fruition, he said that the boughs of the trees hung over. I mean, that's just how much fruit there was laden on these trees. And yet, you know, but from Christianity's point of view, they said, well, good God, so the man messed up, and by God, you know, God's, you know, he's got to come up with a plan of salvation for this idea. And that's just not how it goes. This was planned from here before anything was created. All of this was determined by Yahweh before even he set forward. Because when this came forward, we're talking about Elohim, who was the archetype original pattern. See, Yahweh, pure spirit, went out of business, and the Son did the work. Continue reading.
Revelation chapter 17, verse 1.
Read.
And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, come hither. I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore.
Marker. Anybody got a marker?
That sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication.
The wine of her fornication. See, now, keep your finger there. Keep your finger there. Get Isaiah 27 and 1.
Isaiah 27, verse 1.
Mm-hmm.
In that day, Yahweh, with his sore and great and strong sword, shall punish Leviathan.
Go ahead, that's a great sea monster, a beast that travels the sea, like a fish, right?
The piercing serpent.
The piercing serpent, why is he saying that? Isaiah is drawing from what Moses wrote. Moses wrote about a piercing serpent back here. Talk about Lucifer up here in the garden. See, he's drawing out from what Moses wrote. Continue.
Even Leviathan, the crooked serpent.
The crooked serpent. See, he's drawing from what was written. See, law, prophecy. Go ahead.
And he shall slay the dragon in the sea. If that day sing ye unto her a vineyard of red wine.
Vineyard of red wine, see, because she's drinking the blood of the martyrs. Read.
I, Yahweh, do keep it. I will water it every morning, lest any hurt it. I will keep it night and day.
Mm-hmm.
Fury is not in me.
That's good enough. Go back to Revelation. Because John, what we're reading, he's confirming what Isaiah is writing, who is confirming what Moses wrote. Read.
Yes. With whom? Verse 2 of Revelation 17.
Mm-hmm.
With whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of their fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness.
Uh-huh.
And I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns.
Seven heads and 10 horns. And keep them in mind. Go ahead.
The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold.
Purple and scarlet. See, that's two of the colors on the veil, ain't it? There's a veil of the flesh. She let you know she's guarded. She is wrapped in the flesh. Read.
And precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Revelation 7, verse 5. And upon her head was a name written, Mystery.
Mystery.
Babylon the Great.
Babylon the Great.
The mother of harlots and abominations of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the sun.
Why? Because he's confirming what we read in Isaiah. To my John, see, everything is law, prophecy, fulfillment. If John is confirming what Moses is saying, not just Moses, but also the testimony that is drawn out from what Moses wrote. John is confirming it. Continue.
And with the blood of the martyrs of Yahshua. And when I saw her, I wondered.
Mm-hmm.
Great admiration.
In other words, he was starstruck. You know how it goes. You know, you see some of these, you know, these celebrities, you know, especially the good ones, looking ones, whether they're female or male, you know, you look at you be like, oh God, you know how they get, you know, get all giddy, you know, okay, they were struck, come along. They were starstruck. And he was like, oh wow, you know, he was just the beauty and the glory that he was looking at. And then what?
Revelation 17, verse 7. The angel said unto thee, wherefore didst thou marvel?
Why are you marveling? Why are you starstruck? Read.
I will tell thee the mystery.
I will reveal to you the mystery of this so-called beautiful creature.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And of the beast that carrieth her, which hath the seven heads and ten horns.
Read.
The beast that thou sawest was, and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, and go into perdition.
Go into perdition.
And they that dwell on the earth shall wander, whose names are not written in the book of the of life from the foundation of the world. When they behold the beast that was, and is not, and yet is. And here is the mind which hath wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
The seven heads are seven mountains.
The woman sitteth on. Now, when I came into class, and I'm not knocking it, I was told that the Vatican here, which is at the feet of this image, see, Rome, it sits on seven hills, which it does.
Nice.
I got no problem with that.
Capital E.
See, but here's the thing I want you to consider. John is looking back on the thing from the beginning, from the ending back to the beginning. He's seeing how this thing got started and how it has come along down through the ages and dispensations. So when you talk about a mountain, see, a mountain is a type of a kingdom. Even from a military point of view, they would tell you this, defend the high ground. If you build your castle on a mountain, see, people have to go up a mountain to attack you, whereas you can just look down. And see, it's easier to throw a big rock down on somebody than to try to throw something up. I mean, you understand, that's just common military sense. And if you look at some of these ancient cities, most of them were on an elevated plain. See, because that would give them the advantage. So these seven mountains are representative of seven kingdoms. Continue.
Revelation 17, verse 10. And there are seven kings. Five are fallen. And one is. And the other is not yet come.
Now, stop. Now, the one who is writing this is John on the Isle of Patmos. This is AD 96. So, from his perspective, he says there are seven kings. Five of them are fallen. We have the mark right up here on this chart. See, by AD 96, the city of Enoch is gone. The Tower of Babel is gone. Yeah, I'll be there in a minute. Sorry about that. Babylon is gone. Medes and Persia is gone. And Greece is gone. Five of those kingdoms are fallen in AD 96. And the one that is in AD 96 is pagan Rome. Now, in AD 96, the papacy had not yet come.
That's right.
Finish.
And the other is not yet come. When he cometh, he must continue a short space.
Now, when it do come, and it did come, the Roman Catholic Church, it must continue a short space, which it did. Read.
And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth.
Now he's the eighth. Now what does that mean? See, the Roman Catholic Church got fallen flattened than a, was made flatter than a critter by our founder with his textbook that he wrote in 1961 and sent it to the Vatican.
See, that caused about the Second Vatican Council, which made great changes in the church. That was caused by us. And that made the Roman Catholic Church fall flatter than a fritter. In other words, the way it is now is nothing like it was centuries ago as far as power, depth, and authority, and influence and stuff. They're still around, have a little bit, but not like it was back in the old days. Our founder did that. And see, and now what we're looking at, he just read it, is the eighth satanic kingdom. What does that mean? That means that what we're living in now, since 1961 all up to now, is the conglomeration of all of these kingdoms. In other words, everything is all put together now. So that you can look at things and look, the things we do now, look, we draw from history. See, even the historians would say there's nothing new under the sun, it's just innovations of old ideas. See, we do brain surgery now, but guess what? They did brain surgery 3,000 years ago. Japan, they would get a, you know, skull, you know, tap into your skull and stuff like that. That ain't nothing new. I mean, what we're doing now, they did that thousands of years ago. Sutures and stuff. I mean, the things we do, beer. You think beer is a new thing? Beer is 5,000 years old. Insurance is the same amount of age. They have the Babylonians invented insurance 5,000 years ago. I mean, a lot of things that we take for granted, we say, well, where's all this stuff? It comes from the ancients. We draw from them and we use it, we fashion it, we form it. Look, a chariot, a car is nothing but a chariot, a mechanical chariot. Back in the old days, we had a horse and a chariot riding around. Now you got a car with a motor in it. And when you talk to your friends and say, hell, you got your new car, let's pop the hood, see what's in it. Oh man, it's nice. How much horsepower do you have? You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
See, it's the same principle, just different manifestations. It's all come together, integrated, conglomerated, together.
Merged.
See, merged. Yeah, all of that, see? Continue.
So why I'm over.
Yes. Go ahead.
Revelation 17, verse 11.
Uh-huh.
And the beast that was,
nah,
and is not, even if it's the eighth, is of the seventh, and goeth into perdition.
Now he's going to go into perdition, read.
And the ten horns, which thou sawest, are ten kings,
uh-huh,
which have received no kingdom as yet,
uh-huh,
but received power as kings 1 hour with the beast.
Now that's always been a mystery to many people, biblical people, because they read this chapter and they try to figure out, okay, what is this talking about? I remember when I was in high school, which was quite a while back, there was a book that made a great sensation. It was a bestseller that kind of got, oh, thank you. This was this. Here you go. No offense, but I like black. I think black shows up better on white. There was this book. It was called The Late Great Planet Earth, and it was written by Hal Lindsey. And he was making a prophecy, and at that time, the European Union was kind of like developing and all. And so that now, I think the European Union has like maybe 22 members or something like that. But at that time, it didn't have that many. So he was speculating, well, this European Union might be these 10, you know, kingdoms, these 10 horns, you know, that Revelation is talking about. Well, it's not. For the simple reason is that you have to use the law and the prophets to confirm what these 10 kingdoms are. Okay? Go ahead.
Revelation 17, verse 13. These have one mind,
uh-huh,
and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. For he is the ruler of rulers and king of kings. And they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. And he saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the poor sitteth, are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. And the ten horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, and shall make war, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. For Yahweh hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will, and to agree and give their kingdom unto the beast, until the words of Yahweh shall be fulfilled. Revelation 17, verse 18 ends the chapter. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth.
Okay, good enough. These are the 10 kingdoms, okay? Let us talk about these. When you stop and think about society, society is divided up in these 10 parts. You got agriculture, farming, medical, mercantile, science, technology, manufacturing, the transportation kingdom, buses, trains, planes, ships, theater, sports, entertainment, the political, the military, education, and religion. These are the 10 kingdoms, and there are kings and queens that rule over them, see? And they're the ones that help the beast, so to speak, in their in its operation, in its alliance with it, if you will. Now, I don't know how it is here, but I do know that in America, corporations, you say something about corporate, corporations are considered persons in America. Now, and probably because of what happened in America, it's probably extended more so internationally. The reason why it happened is like this, because they exploited a quirk in the Constitution. I'll try to make this quick. In the Constitution of the United States, when it was first made, you know, and they started, talking about different groups and stuff, the native peoples were given status because they were able to write treaties with them. The black people that were in the United States, because they were slaves, they had no rights. So in the Constitution of the United States, they put a clause in there that said that black people were counted as 3/5 of a person. Now, the reason why they did that was because, see, in the United States, you know, it started off with 13 colonies. There were more people in the northern colonies than in the southern colonies, as far as the Europeans. In the southern colonies, they had more slaves. So when they created the government of the United States, they created two houses, a Senate and a House of Representatives. Now the Senate, it's straightforward, two representations from each state, no matter what your population is. But in the House of Representatives, your representation is based on the amount of population you have in the state. So in the southern states, there were less Europeans there than in the northern states. So to compensate for that, they had the slaves counted as 3/5 of a person. Two slaves would be 6/5, that would equal to one European, and that would give them more adequate representation in Congress, okay? And when the court case came up where they passed a fugitive slave law and it was challenged, the Supreme Court judge who overruled the guy who brought the challenge, He looked at the Constitution of the United States and saw, oh, well, you black people are only just 3/5, therefore you have no rights that a white man is bound to respect. Okay? And that's how slavery kept on in the United States until after the Civil War, and even after the Civil War was done, they had to pass an amendment to the Constitution. Now there are, I think there's like 27 amendments in the United States Constitution. Three of them apply specifically for black people. The 13th, the 14th, and the 15th Amendment. The 13th Amendment outlawed slavery. The 14th Amendment gave black people personhood. In other words, what it did, it nullified that part of the Constitution that said black people were 3/5. So that nullified that, and that gave black people personhood in America. The 15th Amendment gave black people the right to vote. Now, the one I'm going to deal with is the 14th Amendment, because the 14th Amendment is also called the Birthright Amendment. And see, that means simply this. Anybody from around the world, if you just happen to come here and you birth a baby here on American soil or in an American territory around the world, they're automatically an American citizen. And that has happened to a lot of people. One famous person it happened to was Bruce Lee, the famous martial artist. His parents were from China, they were from Hong Kong, and they were traveling across the country doing a show. And then the woman was pregnant, and she ended up having a baby
Bruce Lee was born in San Francisco, even though his parents were Chinese citizens, but because he was born in San Francisco, he was conferred automatic American birth citizenship. So when they, after he was born and they registered him, they went back to China, to Hong Kong, and he grew up in Hong Kong, but when he wanted to come to America, all he had to do was show that, hey, I was born here in San Francisco, I'm an American citizen. And so they let him in. That was because of the birthright of him. He was born there, okay? Now, as I said earlier, this is the amendment that gave black people personhood. Now, in the 19th century, there was a very famous case of a railroad, of a city was suing a railroad because they were like, doing something that was encroaching on their city. You know, and so the railroad said, well, we got rights too. And so they went to court about it. And the Supreme Court of the United States, which is the highest court of the land, ruled in favor of the railroad. They said that the railroad was an entity or was a person, this corporation. So that was the beginning of corporate personhood in the United States, and that's been reinforced by various laws and court decisions. The last one was called the Citizens United, because they said this, corporations said this, well, if we're a person, then we're entitled to the rights of the Bill of Rights, which is the First Amendment, which is that we have the right to freedom of speech, which includes the right to donate money or whatever, because there used to be laws for corporations saying, well, you can only donate so much money. Well, they went to court for that and said, no, we won't go back. We're a person. We have the right to donate as much money as anybody else. And the Supreme Court said yes. So corporations are now persons. Donald Trump is a corporation. And he's a giant. See, these corporations are the giants that rule the land. Just stop and think. The word corporation.
Money.
Yeah. The word corporation.
Corporation.
See, it comes from the word corpus, which means body. See? And when you stop and think about it, just stop and think about this. Now, a corporation is a body on paper. Where does paper come from?
Papyrus.
Or trees. It comes from the vegetable kingdom, the vegetable kingdom, like trees. Well, yeah. Well, see, that's
floor.
That's like the angels. Look.
Floor.
Need a little more room. Look, I see here. All right. This is the sun. This is a tree. I'm a poor artist. This is a tree. This is a person. Now I'm sure you've heard this. See, but there's a symbiotic relationship between the animal kingdom and the plant kingdom. See, the plant kingdom is a type of the angelic creation, okay? That's why over there, you see the angelic and physical creation together. Usually there's a dotted line there because they intertwine with each other. It's like here. See, we breathe in oxygen. See, we and exhale carbon dioxide, all right? We exhale that. Now, the plants, they take the carbon dioxide and see, look, they inhale the carbon dioxide. Now, the part they want is the carbon because it's used for the burning when the light hits the leaves and causes photosynthesis. And you know, and this is how they make their food. They need the carbon to help make their food. See, but the O2 part, that's a waste product. The plants don't need that. So they expel the O2. But guess what? We can use it. We'll take that O2. We'll take the O2 and pass out the carbon dioxide. So there's a symbiotic relationship between the plants and the animals. Okay? Now the plant kingdom is representative of the angelic creation. Corporations is a body on paper. Paper comes from trees. which is like saying, that's the satanic spirit. See, I will be like the Most High. If Yahweh said, I will make a body, Satan said, oh, guess what? I can make a body too. I will be like the Most High. It's the same thing. And see, and in these corporations, there are bodies, they're giant, and they run things. For example, like, I don't know if you ever heard of Pfizer drugs. That's a king in the medical kingdom. See? So you got the military, you got people, you got arms dealers, you know. I mean, they're kings in their kingdom. These corporations, they run this stuff. They're the kings, they're the giants that run it. We be like grasshoppers to them. as far as they're concerned. And listen, they pretty much run the world. You may not think so. They say, oh, well, this government. No, you got the money. It was like, well, she was telling me a little earlier. She was saying, well, they'll play like they're doing something in the government. No, they'll argue. But when the government is over, when after hours, they're up to the street in the bar, sitting laughing, talking, and drinking. You know, yeah, that was the new craze, man. You know? See, because people will say, oh, you know, there's this hidden thing, Illuminati. No, it ain't. It ain't nothing hidden. It's out front and open. You just don't want to see it. People don't want to see it. But with the eyes of understanding, you can see the satanic spirit at work. See, and it's pretty apparent. It's not like, oh, some secret. It ain't no secret. Trust me. It's out in the open. It's very apparent. They're doing it. And they're running it. See? Where you at over there in the Revelations where you were reading?
Yeah. Revelation chapter 18, verse 1.
Uh-huh.
And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven.
Okay. Hold on for a minute. I want you to read verse 9. But before you read verse 9, this is what I want you to get. Ezekiel 28 and 11. But keep that because we're going to get to that. Because I need to go to the law and the prophets to prove what I just said. Because I put this up, people say, oh, this is crazy. But I'm going to show you in the law and the prophets where it says this. Revelations 28 and 11. I mean, Ezekiel 28 and 11. I'm sorry.
Moreover, the word of Yahweh came unto me, saying,
uh-huh.
Son of man, take up a lamentation unto the king of Tyre,
mm-hmm.
and say unto him, thus saith Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
thou sealest of the sun, full of wisdom,
mm-hmm.
perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim. Every precious stone was thy covering. The sardis, the topaz, and the diamond.
Hold for me. Let's talk. I always like to do this. See here, this is called theosophy plate here. Look, Satan's created the image and likeness of Elohim just like everything else. Now I want you to start that over again about the stones.
Thou hast been in Eden, uh-huh. the garden of Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
Every precious stone was thy covering.
Every precious stone was thy covering. See, what's look, these are the attributes. One, continue.
The sardius.
One,
the
two,
and the diamond.
Three,
the beryl, the
four,
arts,
five,
and
six,
the jasper,
seven,
the sapphire,
eight,
the emerald, and
nine,
the carbuncle,
uh-huh,
gold.
And gold, 10. See, he's created, he, I will be like the Most High. And see, this king, don't he has a kingdom? If Yahweh has a kingdom, then say, well, I gotta have a kingdom too. I will be like the Most High. See, and this, and listen, this is the reflection of human, this is what human government tries to do. Human government tries to exhibit these same attributes. Wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love. The government wants you to love you. Love you, want you to love them. You gotta pledge allegiance, you know, and they want that. And when you mess up, they're gonna mete out justice, you know. It's a foundation, you know, they talk about the founding, yeah, because I see it besides, you know, Family's the foundation of, they exhibit that too. They have their own carnal way of exhibiting these attributes. Continue.
Emerald and the carbuncle, the gold, the workmanship of thy tablets,
thy tablets,
and of thy pipes,
mm-hmm.
was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created.
Keep going.
Thou art the anointed cherub.
He's the anointed cherub that covers. See, because he's on the veil. He's on the veil, and that's what's covering. That's what's blocking your view. That's blocking your view of who's sitting on this throne. See, he's on the veil, and he's a bright, beautiful angel on the veil. And you're like, duh. You know? How would you know? You don't know any better. What defense do you have against something like that? No. Continue.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so.
Mm-hmm.
Thou wast upon the holy mountain of Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire.
Read. That's the angels. The stones of fire are the angels. Continue.
Thou wast perfect in thy way,
mm-hmm.
from the day that thou wast created,
mm-hmm.
till iniquity was found in thee.
Now he was perfect in what he was doing. Now let's get this straight. Lucifer was not a good angel gone bad. He was created to be that. It's like a time bomb, you know, like, you know, you got a nice, You know, we could wrap it up in a nice pretty box with a nice pretty bow on it, but you got it, but inside the box, there's a clocket with a stick of dynamite in there. And you know, here you go. He was a time bomb, and look, he was the brightest. Listen, if stars are a type of angels, and I used to be an amateur astronomer, they used to measure the brightness of a star by what is called magnitude. In other words, they could look at a star and say, well, you know, this star here is the brightest star in the sky, therefore, we'll say, we'll give this a star, its brightness is of the first magnitude. And then you say, well, this star here is not as bright as that. It's bright, but not as bright as the first one. So we'll say that star is of the second magnitude, and so forth and so on. Lucifer was an angel because of his beauty and wisdom and brightness. He was an angel of the first magnitude. See, which was why one-third was, he was able to draw one-third of an innumerable host because of his great magnitude, of his brightness. Continue.
Love has defiled the sanctuaries. Thine heart, verse 17, thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty, and thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness.
Now see, prior to him doing this, Lucifer was leading the choir. He was leading the choir, you know, because angels give honor and praise and glory. Prior to him doing it, he was leading the choir. You know, he was like, come on, y'all. All praise El Him, all praise El Him. Come on, y'all, y'all need to keep up. Don't make me look bad here. That was Lucifer. Till iniquity was found in him, until a time bomb that Yahweh set went off. And then he starts saying, well, look, I don't see anybody as bright as I am. I don't see anybody up here as wise as I am. I don't see anybody up here as beautiful as I am. I must be the salvation. Excuse me, angelic creation, your salvation has arrived. That was Lucifer. Continue.
Thy heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted the wisdom by the reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings, that they may be with thee. Thou hast defiled the sanctuaries by the multitude of thy iniquities.
By the multitude of thy iniquities, read.
By the iniquity of thy traffic.
The iniquity of thy traffic.
Therefore.
Wait a minute. What is traffic? Are we talking about a busy intersection where you got a honk before you go? No, he's talking about buying and selling. Traffic, by the iniquity of thy traffic, your merchandise. Read.
Therefore will I bring forth a fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. All they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shalt thou be anymore.
All right. Now, go back to Revelation, because it just said in the testimony, by the iniquity of thy traffic, of thy, you know, which is merchandise. Now we're going to see John confirm it. Revelations 18 and 9.
Revelation 18, verse 9. And the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously with her shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgment come, and the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her. For no man buyeth their merchandise.
In other words, nobody is trafficking with them. Get it? Read.
Revelation 18, verse 12. The merchandise of gold.
Hold. Now, before he starts reading, he's going to read off a list of stuff. All you got to do is, when you hear what he says, just find a category for it up here somewhere. Okay? Continue.
The merchandise of gold and silver and precious stones and of pearls and fine linen and purple, and silk, and scarlet, and all tying wood, and all manner of vessels of ivory, and all manner of vessels of most precious wood, and of brass, and iron, and marble, and cinnamon, and odors, and ointments, and frankincense, and wine, and oil, and fine flour, and wheat, and beasts, and sheep, and horses, and chariots, and slaves, and souls of men.
Damn, you a commodity too, Egypt. You a commodity. See, souls of men, he's trading in all that, including you. You're a commodity to be bought, sold, bartered for, traded for. How does that happen? I'll give you a good example. I know what they used to do in the United States. I know. You ever hear of Billy Graham? You know, I mean, when I come up, he was a very famous preacher. You know, I mean, he was an evangelist. And he would go around all across the country, these different places, and he would he'd preach, and I mean, he'd bring in thousands. I mean, sometimes they'd have to rent a stadium to go get him, you know, to fill up the people that they expect to come. Now, when Billy Graham would come, all right, I'll use an example here. Let's say Billy Graham came to Spanish Town, all right? Now, he came to Spanish Town, and he's this big, famous evangelist preacher, and I don't know, you know, preacher, you know, I don't know what the biggest place is, but you find a place for him that can hold, I don't know, 5,000-10,000 people or something like that, you know, a big auditorium that, you know, bring a whole bunch of people. And he's up there because he was one of them old fiery type of preachers. And the people, you know, they get to going, and then at the end they say, now, if you want to turn your life over to Jesus, come on down to the front, you know, and we'll pray for you, and all that. And people will come down and they'll pray, you know, and they'll be converted, stuff like that. Okay. The session is over. Billy Graham don't live in Spanish Town. Billy Graham, he's moved on. But see, the people who got converted, what are they going to do? Well, see, for Billy Graham to come, he would have to be invited by the local preachers here in Spanish Town. See, and so when Billy Graham is gone, they would just ask, you know, friend, where do you live at? Well, I live on the north side of Spanish Town. Well, here's Reverend So-so. He's got a church over there. You can go over there. And he might ask you, so where do you live at? Well, I live over here on the south side of Spanish Town. Oh, well, so-and-so, he's got a church over there. You can go to that church. In other words, they've got all these souls down here, and now they're giving them up. See, Billy Graham gone. But see, now, you know, the rest of the preachers here, they're trying to, you know, okay, let's see, I'll take this one, and this one, and this one, and this one. You see what I'm saying? That's how it works. They just dividing up the souls, and, you know, and then you trapped over there, you in church, you know, you've been bought and bartered, traded for a soul. Your soul, because you didn't come down here because you're thinking, oh, Billy Graham is so, but then next thing you know, he's gone, and then the local preacher comes, oh, how you doing? I got a church over here. You believe that? Yeah, you come to my church, okay? Dividing up, giving up. Is there anything else there?
Revelation 18, verse 14 continues. Mm-hmm. And the fruits that thy soul lusteth after are departed from thee. And all things which were dainty and goodly are departed from thee, and thou shalt find them no more at all. The merchants of these things which were made rich by her shall stand afar off for the fear of her torment, weeping and wailing, and saying, alas, alas, that great city that was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls. For in one hour so great riches come to naught, and every slave master, shipmaster, and all the company in ships and sailors, and as many as trade by sea stood afar off, and cried when they saw the smoke of the burning, saying, what city is like unto this great city? And they cast dust on their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, alas, alas, that great city wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea by reason of her costliness. For in one hour is she made desolate.
All right. Now, see, that's at the universal revelation. And listen. The whole earth is Babylon. Why? Because it's declaring the end from the beginning. In the beginning of time, back here in the antediluvian age, the whole earth was under one rule. See, the city of Enoch, their family ruled. It was under the globalists. People talking about all the globalists. But Cain was, these were the globalists because they conquered the world. Cain, Nimrod, Nebuchadnezzar, Cyrus, Darius, all the Xerxes, Alexander the Great, the Caesars, the Popes. They're the globalists. They conquered the world. But yet all of that is going to be to naught. Okay? I heard that now, but I just want to get one more scripture in here. And I think it's Philippians 3:20. Because see, that's the world. You have been drawn out of the world, so to speak. Spiritually, yeah, I know, you still gotta go to work, gotta pay bills and all that, but you don't, see, you don't have to be of that world. Yeah, we in the world, but we don't have to be of it. It's like what we were saying the other day, hey, look, be ye wise as serpents, but harmless as doves. Mm-hmm. See, understand what you're dealing with in the world. We have Philippians 3:20.
Philippians 3 verse 20. For our conversation,
who has a holy name?
For our citizenship.
That's it. That's the word I want. See, our citizenship. See, you think you're a citizen of Jamaica, or I'm a citizen of America. That ain't our true citizenship. Your citizenship is in heaven. It's in Yahshua.
Yes.
That's your true citizenship, not this. Oh yeah, you know, when I leave here, I go, I got a passport. But that's what the world wants. But my true citizenship is in Yahshua. Read.
For all your citizenship is in heaven,
uh-huh.
From whence also we look for the Savior, the Redeemer, Yahshua the Messiah.
Yahshua Messiah, who is our Savior King. See? Because if we're citizens of a government, then every government got to have a head. The head of our government is Yahshua the Messiah. That's the head of our government in here. Because he's the one, because the true government, not human government, the true government is the Holy Spirit in you, and you recognizing it and allowing it to govern your actions. Like the high priest, run that course without deviation. See? To avoid the pitfalls and the snares of the world. Because it's easy, look, we just went. Look how easy it is to fall into this stuff. They say, well, one of these is gonna get you. And they run it too, these corporate, they run it. And it's getting to the point now that they own everything. We just read it, they run everything.
Rough
including shot. The souls of men.
Rough shot.
But we want you to be aware of that, and we want you to come out of Babylon, my people. And be not partaker of her plagues. And therefore, that's why I say, you be part of that first resurrection, the second death, which will happen to this image and the 10 toes that it stands on. That will be part of, that will be thrown into the lake of fire. But you will be spared there because we are in Yahshua the Messiah, who is our Savior King, who is the true government of the universe. Okay? Thank you for your time and patience. And with those few words, thank you, Yahshua.
King 794 B, Old Oak Road, Wednesdays, and Fridays from 6 and 8.
Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please stand for that. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory, with exceeding joy to the only wise Elohim, Yahshua the Messiah, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, but now and forever, we say.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Appreciate you doing it. I lost power. It's full. It's full because it's got a light here. The connection was somehow wasn't good enough. I don't know what to say. Because I know it didn't have enough power. It ran out of power, so it quit streaming. But I got it all on tape, so that's no problem. You know, that's my fail safe.
What's that one?
I don't know. I bought this new cord because I was having problems with the connection, and somehow it wasn't connected well enough, and it just ran out of power. That's just what happened.
So you want anything?
No, I'm okay. As far as, do you need anything for the? Well, I don't know. What are you gonna? You shooting right? What are you gonna bring? You need any lights or anything? It's gonna be doing today, so it should be pretty fun. I was there before, and I remember it was doing. It was okay.
Yeah, so physically.
Oh. Well, no, I'm okay for the moment, with the exception of. Yes, sir.
Let me know if, just in case.
All right. Will do.